I'm Ed.
Ed, nice to meet you.
You too. You said nice to meet you.
So you mentioned something important, you talked about anger. And there are certain things that people incline towards that unfortunately prevents them from intellectually understanding a circumstance. And that thing, for example, is anger. And we talked about how, for example, there's a prophetic tradition, Yesenia's analogy, that teaches a person shouldn't judge between two other people while they are angry. So sorrows or stress, they deduce from that other elements that could lock out the mind, such as hunger, extreme hunger, right? And I think some of us have felt that when you're hungry, how hard is it for us to actually read and receive the information? How much concentration do we have? Hunger, fatigue, thirst, sleep, emotional impulses. Emotional impulses such as some people may have extreme elements of, for example, unfortunately, thought, extreme elements of thought. For some people's lives, not everything is very black and white, as you guys know. For some people, if you look closer than usual, a chair is not necessarily something solid. It's not monolithic. A chair, you use a microphone, deeper and deeper, smaller and smaller. What happens to the chair? What happens to the song? It eventually comes into what?
Consciousness, a collection of parts.
Yeah. Essentially, particles, etc. They come together. So people, depending on the individual, so anger, emotion, fatigue, sleep, thirst, among other things as well. And one important thing is to be having the intrinsic trait of integrity and halim. Halim in Arabic means forbearance, to be forbearing. That's an extremely important element. Unfortunately, that is missing out on a lot of people. So we talked about these things. We talked about this in a role in which you are in a position in which you have subordinates, for example. And you'd be surprised, not every one of us is a president of the United States, we know that. However, every one of us does have some sort of subordinates between their lives. Whatever it may be. It could be a husband, it could be a wife, it could be children, it could be a friend at school, it could be your partners in a project, and it can also be your schoolwork in and of itself. Consequently, the concept of forbearingness, which was an impeding, important concept in which was emphasized tremendously in the Islamic society, particularly individuals that have a voice, particularly individuals that hold a post. And I overheard you talking about elections, is that correct? Forbearingness, what is important, extremely important, unfathomable, uncomprehendable how important it is when we take it into consideration of leadership. What does that say? Portending and presaging, right? preceding, you can say it, there are different ways of saying it. What does portending mean and what does preceding mean? Preceding mean. Someone have an idea? Omar?
Portending is like a foreshadow.
Get it?
They used to say like rain, it's a portend of bad things to come. Presaging is very similar synonym, but it's usually not attributed to a person. A person doesn't presage.
Okay.
It's just something that is. But their synonyms, usually, I think they're used interchangeably a lot. My understanding.
Yeah, okay. Do you remember the title of last week's lecture, what it was?
Not the title.
So the title is actually basically the rules that we hope for every class we're able to take with us. So last week was emotional consciousness, right? Being aware of your emotions. That's quite simple, right? So today's observation, today's rule in Islamic epistemology is portending and presaging in situational circumstances in which you have to be a judge. Okay, I'm not talking about you, as we talked about previously, sitting on a desk and you have the wooden hammer ordering the court. We're not talking about that. We're talking about everyday circumstances. Everyday circumstances. Particularly right now in a time in which there is a lot of ambiguity, there's a lot of confusion out there, and there are a lot of misconceptions that are out there. So, consequently, being conscious of your emotions, where you're weak, if you have anger problems, you gotta be aware of it. You have to pretest and pre-modify. And be aware of what things may lead you to that, and or if you feel it. Same thing. If you have emotional impulses in a different type of format, being aware of that limitation. So today's observation is portending and presaging in circumstances in which you have to be tried to visualize the outcome. What type of things could happen if I choose to do this? What type of things will be the reaction for what I choose of an action? If I choose to say this statement, what will be the reaction of that? What will be the eventual reaction? Furthermore, will this statement last, or this judgment last? Because realistically speaking, not everyone knows how to horseback. Not everyone knows how to ride a particular animal. Not everyone knows how to tie their shoes in a certain fashion. So consequently, if you teach a person how to tie their shoes in a certain fashion, and they don't understand the mechanics of it, they're going to have trouble trying to emulate what you say. Being aware of what it is will happen by your choice, by your speech, by your philosophy, by your action, and every action there is a reaction, as you know. Some observations in its meaning. Portending to indicate in advance. To indicate in advance. To signify, to give warning of. Foreshadowing. Presage, foresight, forecast, make a prediction, foreshadows a future event. Foreshadow a future event. Can you give me a contextual and or a live example of portending?
So, Sheikh, is it the same as in that, being a deer?
Kind of. So nadir implies what? What does that imply?
Basically to warn people of an event that is coming in the future. So you're basically warning.
That's right. So when we warn, if you are a nadir, so apostles are described as nadir.
Yeah.
Not necessarily warning is a synonym of the meaning. But what it entails is basically a lifeline in which hopefully a person will be able to handle a circumstance through a type of philosophy. So what does that mean now? Portending, you talk about being a nadir.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yeah.
In the element of a nadir, he has to portend, and or she has to portend. To indicate in advance, to give a warning of, to foreshadow, to signify things. Intellect, insight. These are all things that are part of that. Insight of the circumstance. What do you think will happen in the next 20 years? What do you think will happen with this type of order? What do you think will happen with this type of law? The list goes on. So having insight, being aware of the things to come, to have a contextual example. Some cultures did teach Viking culture, shake, yeah, look into it. Okay, you shouldn't go to war because of this. Same thing, Kamiskan. He used to have some foreshadowers that he would seek advice from. They tried to look at the future, for example. However, in this case, when we talk about portending and presaging, we're talking about visualizing the repercussions that will happen in the action that you choose. Visualizing what will be the outcome of something you say. Visualizing what will be the result of a position you hold. And especially when you are trying to advise someone else. Especially when you're trying to advise someone else. Because from the fundamental elements of Salaka epistemology is the measurement of yourself and the measurement of others. Not judging others, the measurement of others. If I was a personal trainer, okay, you have to be able to advise a person to their athletic capability. If a person has trouble benching 120 pounds, and you come and you say, hey, if you hit 200, muscles will grow faster. And he tries to do it, what's going to happen to his hand? They start to shake, static muscles kick in, it collapses, and it harms the person. Is that right?
Yes.
Portending, presaging in Islamic epistemology is basically the same thing. If I know, for example, if I try to pick up a weight 200 pounds, it's going to collapse, consequently causing more harm than good, I don't think I should be doing that thing. If I'm going to advise someone about something, and I know they cannot handle 200 pounds in a bench set, I shouldn't be telling him that information. If I'm going to judge in a certain fashion, and I know they're not going to be able to bench press 200 pounds, I shouldn't be saying that. So you should, a person in this observation, this philosophy, is measuring the outcomes for the choices they make. Portending, presaging, very powerful terms, actually, extremely powerful. Extremely powerful. One day, Imam Shatibi was a was in the 7th century scholar from Spain. At that time, Spain was the majority of population of Spain actually followed Islamic theology. And what happened was, he was approached with a circumstance in which, long story short, two individuals, one person comes, he has a lot of wealth, okay, he has a lot of wealth with him, and he had his capabilities to travel, he had a lot of things. However, his intent was he wanted to travel to a particular area. At that time, he wanted to do Hajj, the greater pilgrimage, as is described, one of the pillars of Islam. So he sought his advice, and this imam looks at him, and he talks to him, and he hears what he has to say. He says, what do you think? So he tells him, you know what, I think that you should spend more time on your business. Try to collect a little bit more money. Try to build your business a little bit. Then consider a travel. As you know, travel at that time wasn't an airplane ride, 10 hours and you reach Qatar or whatever it may be. It takes months. It'll take a long period of time. However, what's interesting, another person came to him, weaker physically, in the social class lower, wealth-wise, more poverty, and he asked him the same thing. However, in his method of asking, he said, I will be traveling. He didn't say, tell me your advice. He said, I will be traveling. So this jurist looked at him and he said, you know, Godspeed, as they used to say. May you be blessed on your travels. They hugged each other, they knew each other. And they left. So people were kind of confused. How is it this person who is asked for help from a person who has riches and is healthy, has a business, has his traveling capabilities, the ability to travel, and this guy tells him, don't travel, spend more time with your wealth. They both want to do pilgrimage. and the other person is poorer, weaker, and tougher. Why do you think so? So the third person was asking for advice, the second person was telling it.
I guess like the lack of confidence in the first guy was, I mean, you could see that he was not ready for travel. I don't think he'd be able to forbear just
great.
The journey.
Yeah, that's a great observation. What do you think about that?
I mean, in the same way that he said, except it might have been that maybe the guy who had wealth, he had lingering attachments. If something had happened to his business while he traveled, it would have reflected, he would have put that, I guess, onto kind of his decision to go, as opposed to saying, oh, well, yeah, blah, blah. And so I think that maybe it was his, like you said, portending and researching as to the potential effects of his travel.
Right.
That it could have a negative effect on his business, whereas if he puts his business up to be more sufficient without him, then he wouldn't have that concern. Whereas the man who was ready to go and also didn't have any business necessarily to worry about, he was okay with, or not okay with, but his advice was, that's the business.
Great. That's both excellent observations. I think you also agree. Do you have any observation as to why?
Well, it's like, you know, in my mind, it's like three, four factors are there. And Imam Shatibi, he perhaps used the, you know, the detective approach to, you know, detect things, observing and assessing a person who has a business and, you know, has an intent to travel, but he hasn't made up his mind. And the other person is already made up his mind and wants to travel. So kind of this deductive method seems like very interesting, and the Sheikh told him in, based on the two brothers' observation that maybe if he faces any loss, like, you know, financial or economical loss in the journey, so might be kind of difficult for the first person. So he advised him, build up your economy and financial resources and then travel. And the second person, who seemed that he's already made up his mind, so he gave him his best wishes and prayers and told him that you can bear the you know, the foreseeable or the coming difficulties. So I pray for you that you come strong and grow.
It's a great, great observation by everybody. Right. So we looked at two things, causes and effects. We looked at the inner self, the person, I've noticed from you, which is the most important thing. And then they looked at the exterior elements. And a lot of times, there is a connection between the inner and the exterior, even in the way a person looks, arguably. Except for if your name is Ted Bundy, unfortunately he was a serial murderer. Some people, and the outward looks, it does give an indication as how they are on the inside. This is a philosophy, this is philosophy, and it is debatable. However, some people, you know, you're more comfortable around with. You see them, you're more comfortable around them, you know that this person is going to be a good person. There's no sense of animosity. So the body is considered among certain philosophies as a mirror of what is inside. As a mirror of what is inside. Consequently, you have certain traditions which talks about and other traditions, philosophical, Arabic traditions, also English traditions as well, that talk about this particular. Whatever the case, these are things to consider. Portending, presaging, looking at the person, seeing the person, knowing the person, their circumstance, their capability, their intellect, and helping them out if they need help at that time. Same thing goes for your own self. If you know your limitations, you know if you take this route, you won't be able to complete it. Well, maybe you should measure a different route where there isn't as many mountains. Though at times, mountains do make you stronger. Just measuring the circumstances.
So just,
sure.
Question. Is there any correlations between the Firasat al-Mu'min with the two terms that you described, or no correlation at all?
There's a sensibility of it. And Farasa is basically, what you're saying in Arabic is something, it's like insight.
Yeah.
It is insight. This was something very interesting, particularly in Arab culture. They used to be able to look at a person, they can tell what type of job he had, for example. And it's not necessarily just subject to Arab culture, it was also European, among other things. There were people that were good at reading people. It's simply said in layman's term, reading another person. And in that element of reading, the element of insight is there. So looking at a person, this guy is a good person, he's a kind person, they are confident, among other things. Just the first few minutes you meet. Mm-hmm. Other people, something about this person. Something about this person. Ted Bundy, I talked to you about earlier, unfortunately, 36 murders, among other things. For some people, they got confused by his demeanor. He acted friendly, you see, and unfortunately he seduced people. Consequently, why is this relevant? Is because a person should attempt not to necessarily conclude everything very fast, just because of a few things. Anyone and everyone can give candy. Anyone and everyone can buy candy from Safeway and give you that candy. However, not to be in haste and your judgments at the same time. So there's a balance effect. Ted Bundy, unfortunately, as we said, many of those that were victims of his were females, unfortunately. And it was described that he was a charming individual. He was charming. Charming individual. So in Firasa, instinct, insight, in the circumstances, in your vision, in your interpretation, among other things. What does that say? What does Bab mean? Bab?
Chapter?
Chapter. What is it usually used as? Door.
Okay.
Right there, this is door. That's a Bab. Ain al-Bab, where is the door? Usually that's how it's used. So this is the importance of knowing epistemology, particularly semantics, the meaning of words, right? The meaning of words. So sometimes a word has multiple meanings. And this is one of the things we talked about earlier, how people have gotten confused about certain references, because they misunderstood. They thought it means this because it is used in one method like that, but it's also used in several different ways as well. So that by itself means door, but it can also mean, as the brother provided, chapter. It can also be used as subcategory. It can also mean in reference to entrance into some, entering into a realm, among other things. So it's a very important thing to consider. Very important thing to consider. The next word, Omar, what is it? Ta'awudhi. What does that mean? What was it?
Refuge.
Help. Seeking refuge. Seeking help. Min.
From.
From. But could it also be about? Could it also mean about? It could mean also at times on atop. El Fitan. How you doing? Sir, okay.
Quick.
What does fitan mean?
Yes.
Test is one meaning of it.
It's a very broad category of things.
Oh, a very broad category of
things. Temptation.
Temptation is in there.
The negative connotation.
Yeah. Negativity, trials, tribulations, strife, harm, test, exam, many other things. Many other things. That's a fitan. So this is actually a chapter title in a text called Sahih Bukhari. Bab chapter At-Ta'awudhi min al-Fitan. Seeking refuge, help from al-Fitan. But Fitan here, it means negativity. It means negativity. It means negativity. So negativity implies, for example, mischief. Mischief. At-Ta'awudhi is a noun. Alif lam, the two letters at first, is something is known as alif lam specific. Very good. So it emphasizes a very contextual, broad, powerful statement. However, what is the pronominal? Well, what is a pronominal? Al damir, what is that? What's a pronominal? If I was to say, I and Abdul Rahman entered the car and drove. Who drove?
Driver.
Who was the driver? I and Abdul Rahman entered the car and drove.
That's not clear, but it's you.
It would be me. How would you know that, though?
Because I know you and Abdul Rahman.
You know me and Abdul Rahman. But if you were to read a letter, how would you know who drove? If you were to read a letter and it said, we talked about this before, let's eat grandma, and that's what you read, what does that mean?
Grandma,
you know, unfortunately. Right? So it would be, what does it mean? Let's eat grandma. Let's have dinner, grandma. Right? That would be the meaning. But if you read it, you don't know the damir, you don't know the pronominal. You don't know cultural context, you don't know linguistics, where's the comma, where's the slice, where's all that stuff. I don't know if I like this guy anymore. That's what you're going to conclude. You know?
I don't know if I like this guy.
So this is very important. A lot of people, actually, St. Augustine, Christian scholar, approximately 4th century, he talked about why there was confusion at times and or even extremism within the Christian theology. And his argument was because of the lack of the trivia. Lack of the trivial arts. The arts. Logic, grammar, rhetoric. So in grammar, there's something called the damir. It's the pronominal. And unfortunately, people get confused at times because they don't know what pronominal is. Same thing in the Quran. Same thing. So here, where's the pronominal? What is the pronominal of a ta'awudh? What is it? The pronominal, at Bamir. Who is it referring to, or to what?
So, Fitan,
very good. However, my question is, at Ta'awudh means, we said refuge, help, seeking help, among other precaution.
Seeking help with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Okay, that's one meaning. Very good. So in that observation, prayer to God, I need help. Protect me from this. I think a lot of us have said that on an airplane when it shakes. Oh God, even if we're not sure if God exists or not, it just comes out. God, if you're out there, just let me get through this. Let me get through this shaking. At-Ta'awudhi, the Dhamir, the pronominal, prayer to God. But that doesn't also negate action. Taking the proper steps to protect yourself from something. This is very important. What happens at times is people slightly get confused between supernatural intervention capability, God capability, and the reality you live in. So if you don't know how to swim, and you want to jump into the Pacific Ocean, and you say, I have trust in God, He's going to take care of me. And then you jump in, I don't know if this is a good idea. Even if you prayed the entire night, even if you did all those things. So customarily, what used to be, especially in a traditional point of view, it's concept of prayer, but concept of cause and causation, doing your part. If you have an exam, pray all you want, but you got to put in the work as well. And unfortunately, you're not going to receive revelation to what the test is going to be about.
Yeah.
This is very important. You have to put in that work. This is very important. So the ta'awudh here, min al-fitan, this is actually a fundamental philosophical observation. Imam Bukhari, he places it. Bukhari, as you know, is the religious text.
So that's the final chapter of Bukhari.
It's, this isn't the final chapter. This is actually a subcategory of the last approximate six chapters.
Okay.
Yes, in Kitab al-Fitan.
Kitab al-Fitan.
So a ta'awudh here, again, is you doing your part in protecting yourself. But in the context of what we're talking about now, is protecting the choices you make, because you are measuring what is going to happen through foresight in the future. Now this is important, which brings us to another point we'll discuss shortly. So if you're going to advise someone about something, jurisprudence, whatever it is, daily things, you have to be aware that traditionally there is a philosophy in a religious context and in reality that a person should be prepared to preserve themselves and preserve the society and preserve the person you're speaking to. What are the five dururat in Islamic epistemology? Dururat al-khams.
Yes.
What is it?
حفظ الدين, حفظ المال, حفظ النسل, حفظ العقل, وحفظ ال... Did I say five or four?
You were counting.
Yeah. حفظ الدين, حفظ المال, حفظ النسل, حفظ العقل, وحفظ ال...
Okay, translate.
Yeah, so, you know, the protection of religion, the protection of wealth, the protection of, and حفظ ال... property, I think. Yeah, so property, intellect, and progeny,
when...
Yeah, so basically these are the objectives of, you know, maqasid of Sharia.
Okay, so what are we talking about here? People, they've heard of the five pillars of Islam, they've heard of the six points of Iman. But al-dururat al-khams, for some reason, unfortunately, not a lot of people know them. It is the goals behind the teachings. The preservation of religion versus choice of religion. And as a side point, as you know, compulsion in religion is...
It's not allowed.
It's not allowed. Islamically. Why? What type of verb? Why? Why do you think so? Compulsion to force someone through religion for the purpose of religion. What was that? We have free will. We have free choice. Inside of ourselves. What else?
If you're forced to do something, it's a philosophical ideology, and you don't believe it, then they force what you want, but you don't believe it.
So, one might argue the most famous thing that is acknowledged to be liked by every culture is chocolate. Okay? I know it seemed like I was going to say something very, very deep when we're talking about chocolate. Right? It's chocolate, right?
Yes.
However, I think a lot of people like chocolate. Maybe some people are allergic, but generally speaking, it's common. That said, if you force someone to eat chocolate and you keep forcing them, you think they're going to like it. You like this chocolate, you love the caramel in it, but if you force someone else to get it, they're going to push away, naturally. Consequently, from the fundamental statements in the Quran, for example, there's no compulsion in religion. There's no compulsion in religion. Also the concept that ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا لَعَلَّكُمْ يَتَذَكَّرُونَ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَذَكَّرُونَ. Examples are proposed for people to think about, so it may be a means for the betterment of themselves. Religion is sincere advice. And people, they choose whatever they want. Very important. At-ta'awudh min al-fitan. Very important things. Dururat al-khams, the goals behind the philosophy, religious philosophy, preservation of religious faith, preservation of children, life, preservation of a person's intellect, preservation of a person's wealth, the property, and then it goes into some category. So this is basically the essential of what Islam teaches, isn't it?
What's the definition
of dururat? Yeah, dururat is the impeding five points. So dururat is extremely important. It is the foundational elements. And khams is five.
This was all played by
also, yeah, Shatubi. So this is very important. So now, in that light, when we think about this, a ta'awudh, a person should be aware of these things, these five points. You know, if I'm going to say something and it's going to destroy someone's intellect, I don't know if that's going to be the best advice you can give to someone. If I'm going to say something and it's going to harm children and life outside, I don't know if that's going to be good advice to give somebody. Also, my own choices. You know, the statement, the religious statement, when I talked to them for a second, do not kill yourselves, in Allah kana bikum rahima, verily God to you is merciful. These are all things that fall into that statement. I'll try to get through this a little bit faster, inshallah. So, ta'awudh min al-fitan, we've been talking about this. Some prayers that used to be said, asking God to support you in times of your riches. When a person is rich, preservation from al-fitan, strife, tribulation, degradation, corruption, mischief, harm, in times of wealth. Why do you think in times of wealth this philosophical prayer used to be taught traditionally by Prophet Muhammad? Why do you think? Why specifically wealth? He said wealth. Why? In times of riches. What was that? That's a very important thing. Because wealth could be something that's used for good, but it can also be a cloud, a dark cloud that covers your mind, that covers your heart, that covers many things, unfortunately. And at times, a person has a mountain of wealth, but then for some reason, they also want a second mountain of wealth. And once that second mountain of wealth is there, they want a third mountain of wealth. If a person doesn't control themselves, unfortunately. So,
why is that?
Why do you think so? Why do you brothers and sisters think that wealth has that type of effect on people?
Because trying to survive and not feeling
tempted to never go after that
state,
so one of the very, very, very important characteristic that Islamic epistemology teaches philosophy is the steps that may lead a person to arrogance. Okay? Now, arrogance is not a sense that you're proudful of who you are. My mother's from here, my father's from there, my descent is from here or there. It's not arrogance. Arrogance is described traditionally as belittling that of goodness, of truth, rejecting it, and looking down, degrading other people, just because of a certain exterior matter. The tradition, God doesn't look to your outward appearance, to your color of your skin, the height of your height, the strength of your strength, but looks to your heart and your actions. That's a very powerful thing to think. So you'll find, consequently, that there were things that they used to talk about, judges, that if they were means to make a person arrogant, they used to denounce it. In that, for example, historically, Genghis Khan and others, they used to wear their robes very long. It used to drag on the floor. It was a sign of honor, prestige, position, social class, wealth. So consequently, I have a teaching. Anyone who does so out of arrogance is a state of negativity. And things from there also build from it. Wealth, power, these type of things. So wealth could be something that is, you can use it for so much good. Education, helping the poor, many other things. But it can also be a thing, unfortunately, at times, which can corrupt the mind. It can corrupt the mind. And there are a number of other things people, I'm sure, can think about why. But just because of time, I'm trying to get through this really fast. Another thing that's talked about, ta'awudh, seeking help, support from certain circumstances, refuge, from a circumstance in which there is an extreme level of poverty. Why poverty now? Helping me through poverty.
So there is a hadith that is kind of fakwa and kufra. So, you know, it leads to kind of very extreme situation that people, you know, lose their...
It may lead to extreme circumstances.
To lose their theology and creed and do mischief.
Yeah, so here, in that sense, it could be a means that it makes a person insane. It can reach that state, status. So kufr, against some reason, I think this is something just to touch on very fast, people like to translate it as infidel or blasphemy and these type of things. Kufar, infidel and these type of things. It's not necessarily the case. And infidel actually wasn't something that was necessarily used linguistically in the Islamic philosophy, but it was used to describe other people by a third party. So actually, people of the Islamic philosophy were described as infidels at one point. But for some reason, the word seems to be adopted by some. And linguistically, kufar doesn't mean infidel. And kufr doesn't mean that. The essential meaning of it is that a person has bestowed upon you grace and goodness, and you have turned away from it through arrogance. So that's the essential meaning of that word. But this is very important. So consequently, in a relative basis, friend, when you look historically versus the Quran and these things, the word infidel is not there. It is describing something deeper than that. So these are things very important to remember. So we're talking about poverty, its effect on the intellect. It could lead a person to extremes, unfortunately. There's a parent, he has children, they need to spend on their children. Unfortunately, they don't have enough support. Though it's not okay, some people have went into extremes to try to get money at times, unfortunately. It's unfortunate. So the thought process that we're discussing here is ta'awudh min al-fitan. The thought process behind that is that a person just takes the precautionary means that are there intellectually, spiritually, physically, so you don't reach a point in which it turns into a type of mischief and or mischief harms you. Praying to God is one method if you're a religious individual. But also, the concept of taking your precautionary means to do so. رَبَّنَا لَا تَجْعَلْنَا فِتْنَةً لِلَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. This is a very powerful verse. A prayer from the chapter called the Mumtahana, chapter 5, verse 45, Quran. God, don't make us fitna, tribulations, trials, mischief, etc., for those that have not necessarily understood. Wow, what does that mean? It's a very powerful thing. People get confused about it. You know, it's a very powerful thing. This was a supplication, if you look in a historical sense, context. I think people, they know the social demographics of the early period. Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, born 570, claims to have received revelation 610, passes away approximately in the year 623 AD. In his time period, there were social demographic issues, slowly but surely. Eventually, as many people know, unfortunately, people who attest to the Islamic theology were subjected to xenophobia, in a sense, religious xenophobia, marginalization, and death at times, other extremes. What happens is, they find refuge in a people nearby, they say, why don't you guys come live with us? And they do so. However, the supplication still remained, because there's a verse that says, اِدْفَعْ بِالَّتِي أَحْسَنْ. If someone transgresses it against you, return that transgression in a fashion that's better. So the supplication was there. What was that supplication? Don't make the circumstance a means for a person's negativity. So these people that are transgressing, don't allow the circumstance, a philosophical argument, that causes them to corrupt themselves and consequently transgress even more. It's a very powerful verse. Sometimes a person, because this is also implied, wealth, and the person who's poor. For some people out there, unfortunately, they think because you're rich, that is a divine gift from God, that He loves you. You're poor is a divine gift from God that He doesn't love you. You're powerful, that's an indication God loves you. But the weak is not. This is how some people, they think, unfortunately, at times. So the verse is teaching us this isn't the case. Every circumstance has a circumstance. However, for these people, with this strength and their wealth, at times it is a means in which they look to other people that are beneath them and they say, this means I'm better than them. This means I'm better than them. The verse implies such things. That people who have been confused by material circumstances that they pray to God to help these people so they don't continuously transgress in these circumstances, which leads them to great harm. For example, negativity or production of negativity, among other things. It's a very deep, powerful idea. What does that say? Who knows?
As-alullah al-fikratan fa-inna fiha fasadun wa lafikun.
The time of fitra, you can realize who's there.
Yes. It's basically, you know, the kind of, you know, the hasad is very interesting term here. That
it's about this harvesting, right?
Yeah, harvest. You know, so the harvest is kind of to disaggregate or deconstruct, you know, the hypocrites from the true believers in you know, you cannot reach that status unless you have a test, you know, the trials and tribulations. So that's how, you know, this
I understood.
Yeah.
So why did I put this here? Because it's a wrong philosophical observation.
Yeah.
But some people, they think it.
Ask Allah.
Yeah, what it's saying.
Right?
Yeah, so what it's saying is that pray to God that He causes tribulations and hardships in people's lives.
So you can,
because in it, you can distinguish between two-faced people.
But we're not supposed to.
You're not supposed to. The reason why we place it here is to show that this is incorrect. It's not correct. And this is a very long topic, it's a very important topic, it's a very powerful topic. And unfortunately, at times, there could be emotion in a person's life, okay? A person just has a character. And they have outlived themselves in a negative fashion. They become religious, and now they use a disguise, to outlive this emotion through a type of religious fashion, for example. So some people, on one side, what it is that they are, just naturally, they like tribulations, they like to cause problems in people's lives, they like to cause ambiguity and hatred between people, animosity. They become religious. Ah, now we do it as a religious reason. Confederacy, that. Now we're going to do it religiously. I'm going to find these outlets and I'm going to do so. So here, pray to God that for trials, tribulations, hardships, these type of things, because it's a means to clarify, to differentiate between the two-faced individuals. So that philosophy is not correct. It's an incorrect philosophy.
Also, there is a verse.
Go ahead.
You know, Al-Yahiz Allah al-Khabith al-Tayyib. And also,
here, what is it saying?
Yeah, so this is that, you know, you want it intentionally.
Exactly.
You know, and that's not the, you know, the, you know, the needed or the, like,
compromise.
Yeah. So, like, you know, we don't want this status. But Allah puts the trials anyway.
Let's see. Let's see.
It's just an add to this, because sometimes this is, as you said, it is wrong. So, but it is really big in our religion. And it's a lot of people use it.
You mean popular?
Yeah.
Popular.
So, we want to see how they establish this. We can know that it's actually true in the time of Fitna. They distinguish, as he said, the means of the people play. Because it happened in Islam, but it's caused by Allah and Allah, not in the community or in some.
Kind of.
Yeah. So, the problem, the way they interpret this, is they think they are right by bringing it from a different circumstance to a community.
Interesting.
Yeah, but that's like just one interpretation. Yeah, you know, this is just one perspective.
So, again, see, this is really fast. Remember here, Is'Allah al-Fitna. What does that mean?
Ask God.
Ask God to cause these things. Ask God to cause these type of things. Now, asking God indicates what? It indicates action. But it can also indicate, from there, your action as well. Let me cause something as well, so I can make something that differentiates people in society.
What is this?
This is just a statement. It's a statement that is prevalent among certain people's minds, philosophical observation.
So, who came up with this?
Certain certain people through history. This isn't necessarily an Islamic philosophy. I just want to clarify this.
Yeah, no,
this is in Arabic. It's used in Arabic. Because Allah, as you know, it just means God.
Yeah, it's God
from it means God. So consequently, you'll find throughout history, whatever it is, prayer to God, prayer to this thing, cause these things so that we can prove who's good and who's not. These type of things. Here's the translation of the meaning of that observation. Previously, I want us just to think of something very quick. What does this say? What does that say? Wait a minute.
Ask God
to take it away, right? To take it away. What does these traditions teach? Protecting yourself from fitan. Look at that ayah about ja'ala fitna lil kafar, among other things. So, Umar al-Khattab, he was a disciple prophet. He's standing there, and there was an intense moment, and he says in front of all these people, Prophet is present, he says to him, "Oh God, protect us from tribulations, trials, hardships." He makes a supplication in his presence. In Sahih Bukhari. So what happens is the Prophet is listening to him and he agrees with that supplication. You see, he agrees with that supplication. Because the observation really, we talked about Dururatul Khams.
Yes.
Preservation of life, which is one of the things, is the most important aspect of it. If you want the destruction of people's lives, unfortunately you have misunderstood something. If religion is making you more angry, more aggressive, and the list goes on, there has to be a re-evaluation of what this religiousness is. It should be the opposite. Right? It should be the opposite. Jesus was very charismatic. People loved him. Muhammad was very charismatic. People loved him. They were willing to humble themselves. They were welcoming people. They understood people's circumstances. And the list goes on. Now there's an interesting perspective here just to think about. Before we get into this, and we'll wrap it up inshallah. There was a person by the name of, he was considered a disciple of Muhammad. So I said his name was Abdullah ibn Hudhafa ibn Qais. Okay? And he was a pioneer. Long story short, he migrates to Habasha. Habasha is where?
Ethiopia,
this area, but closer to Ethiopia. And while there, as you know, why did they migrate is because there was a Christian king, Najan, right? Who was a honorable man. He allowed people to live freely, whatever religion they liked. That philosophy was practiced by Muhammad in Medina. It was a pluralistic society. There was Jews living there. There was no problems. Jews were living there. They used to go to the marketplace and buy and sell. Muslims were there. Some Christians would come through. Polytheistics were there, among other things. And there was actually a contract between them. It's called the
Mawathiq of Medina.
So what happens is this man eventually travels. He goes to Syria, and he actually is captured in Syria, and he's imprisoned. And this king. What we're talking about, a person from the Arabian Peninsula, going to Syria, now he's captured. And this king meets him, and he holds him captive. And you guys know the social circumstances of that time. Imprisonment was normal, usurpation was normal, to usurp, transgression. You guys know how this is 1,500 years ago, 1,400 years ago. He's there, and the king gets a chance to speak to him. And he's intrigued by this person's character. He's intrigued by his character. He talks to him about what's your philosophy, what is this man you're talking about, among other things. And this is very important because it's a time of communication. He already had preconceived thoughts. This king had preconceived thoughts about the Arabs, about Islam, about these disciples, among other things. And he meets this person face to face, things change. Now you're speaking directly, one-on-one. Wait a minute, those thoughts I used to have, they're not necessarily true. They're not necessarily true. So he talks to him, he spends time with him. It's a long period of time. What happens is interesting because sometimes they do this, but it could be for a certain reason. He imprisons him and leaves him with no food except alcohol. Why is that interesting? Yeah, it's taught, traditionally, abstention of alcohol. But now he leaves him in this room, imprisoned for a number of days, and all he has is alcohol. Okay, now he's here. And we're not talking about the kidney failure, we're not talking about these type of things, the possibilities, kidney stones and these type of things. We're not talking about these things. We're just talking about in a philosophical point of view, philosophically, religious point of view. He's there and he puts us there in his room and he sits there. One day, 2 days, 3 days, he doesn't drink anything. It reaches a point that the guards go to the king and they tell him he hasn't drank anything. If you leave him longer, he's going to die. Okay, a person might hear this and be like, now that's a zealous, that guy is devoted. Okay, he brings him in, he meets him, and he asks him, why did you do that? And he tells him, he says, because he knew, the king knew that it was taught to abstain from such things, religiously that is. And he looks at him and he says, you know, I know that my religion allows me in circumstances when we're in need to drink alcohol.
Absolutely.
I can drink to live. There's a verse that says, don't throw yourselves into destruction. Don't kill yourselves. If you're about to die, you've got to reevaluate what you're trying to do to yourself. You see? So the nourishment, he needed it. However, he told them, he said, because I don't want you to get a wrong impression about what people, about what truly our religion teaches. That's why I stayed away from this. He explained these things to him. And the king says this to him, out of love and respect to him. He says, will you kiss my forehead? Unfortunately, they were kind of prideful, out of honor and respect. If you do so, I'll let you free and I'll let these imprisoned individuals free as well. So he says, of course. Kiss his forehead, feed these prisoners that were illegitimately in prison, frees them. He goes back to Medina, he meets the people, and he tells them what happened. He has his witnesses, he has his proofs, and the people understood and respected that particular thing. And the list goes on. So this is a very important thing to consider. Don't throw yourselves into destruction. There's a very powerful observation behind it. Measuring your circumstance, the situation that you are in, among other things. This is the last slide, just run through it very quick. Visionary circumstances. What is the chapter, I mean, what is the topic of all we've been talking about? Yeah, that's the word. Those two words is what we're talking about. We're talking about those fiqh rules, juristic rulings, observations. The meaning of it, we use some examples just to consider it in the light of that. Visionary circumstances. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, Imam Abi Hanifa, they talked about the importance of female judges. Here he's talking about states, positional positions, positions of authority. Wait a minute, I thought Islam doesn't teach that. I'm sorry, you're wrong. Very powerful things. Mufti, what is a mufti? A scholar.
One who issues a verdict.
Verdicts, and particularly in the concept of religious verdicts, among other things. A judge, a concept of law of a society. There has been a number of female heads of state. Maybe people don't know that, talk about historically. Why is this important? Because I'll just give a side point here, just for us to think about something here. The science of hadith, there's a concept of weak narrations, fabricated narrations, good narrations, sahih narrations, these type of things. And it's a very deep science. It is the concept of authenticating historical facts. And you find great works. They have names of all these people, their lives, and who they were as a person. This person used to lie, this used to be a trustworthy person, this used to be very honorable with his wealth. The list goes on. For the preservation of information, they say. Because if he's honorable in the things he says and preserves his respects of other people and the promises, that's going to be hopefully an indication that he speaks truth. It's not going to fabricate information. So this is one of the methods they used to do in authenticating historical texts. But what's interesting, historically, these vast motions of works, this male, that male, that male, that male, not one female was mentioned. Oh. Why do you think so?
Because there is not a single occasion that a female scholar narrated that she had lied.
Exactly, she lied. Scholar, female scholar, judge.
She never lied. She
never lied, historically in this science. That's why no female was mentioned inside. Some of the most powerful, knowledgeable scholars in Islam were females. In the light of what we were discussing, a lot of time the insight, her experiences will be different than a male's experience. And the circumstances in her observation could bring about more compassion, for example. You don't know. And or they've experienced things in lives that males we haven't experienced. So they can relate to a person's circumstance. We cannot be mothers, we can be fathers, because we're male. But they can be mothers, for example, among other things. So in the light of what we've been discussing, using that as insight. You know, as a person, you've experienced, if I was to advise this person in this fashion and they're not going to be able to successfully pass the time frame, I don't know if I should be advising that. Because I have experience, I have intellect, I have insight. I know I'm a person who's lived through that. I'm a mother, for example. Presidents and options as not to oppress and to overburden. Slow and steady wins the race, as they say. Slow and steady wins the race. It's responding to someone, knowing their capability, and not wanting to say something that will make them lose the race in the end. And or you yourself losing the race in the end. We'll start with this statement here. What does this say? What does that say as a judge?
Learning from the insights. So at the time of, as a judge, there's a problem, you can understand the reasons.
Exactly. No one is perfect. No one knows everything. Use each other. Use the experiences of other people. That's what it's saying, basically. Use the observations, the opinions, the experiences of other people in reaching your goals. And using that insight, so hopefully in the long run, people will be successful. قال أصحابنا يستحبون يحضر مجلس أهل العلم من كل مذهب حتى إذا حدث حادثة يفتقروا إلى أن يسألهم عنها سألهم ليذكروا أدلتهم فيها وجوابهم عنها فإنه أسرع للاجتهاد وأقرب للصواب. This is missing from a lot of people's lives. This is missing from a lot of people's lives. Juristically, schools of thought is missing from this. But at the same time, individual.
Yeah, so, Sheikh, yani, this is meant that generalization of fatwas to different contexts is a very serious problem. Like, you know, there is a certain context and situation in a mufti of that area, he gives a fatwa. The other people, they generalize that fatwa, like, you know, for the whole world or for the whole, you know, continent. That's like a serious problem, you know, emerging now in the Muslim world.
Sure. So in that light, what he is saying is that cultures are different all around the world. So secondary elements depends on the culture of the people. Do you see? Consequently, certain thoughts that are out there isn't a representation of the entirety, the monolithic observation. Not everything is monolithic. So in this observation, you propose something in a different light, which is in schools of thought. However, the light that we're talking about is just listening to other people. It's simple. Listening to their opinions. Listening to their reasons, their reasoning, their experiences. And hopefully you can work together to better a circumstance. And if life throws lemons at you, make lemonade. It's very simple. We're in it together, it really is. We are. We're in it together. What do I mean by that? As human beings, we're in this boat together. We are rocking the boat together. And if you think you can do everything by yourself, unfortunately, you're going to be very limited in everything you do. Allah.
This is a very powerful.
Thank you.
Actually, not only believing, but sitting.
It's a very, 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 very important thing to have. Very important thing to have in your lives. Allahu Akbar. Looks like a little reward.
Yeah, I think we can have you know, like 10 minutes for Q&A, and then you know, we can start. You know, then came with you, Aziz, and other brothers, sisters. 10 minutes for Q&A, so we ask questions from Shaykhin. Responsible, did we start our MSA meeting?
Sure. If there are any questions,
yeah,
feel free to ask them, inshallah. And our observations, feelings, thoughts, whatever it may be.
I have so many, but you know, I'm giving you to ask because I have a lot of questions to shake. Is, like, okay, so if nobody.
I feel like I should be taking off my jacket. It's very, it's very intense in here.
Yeah. So I found this, like, very. Interesting and overwhelming for me that the last book of the Bible is the book of Revelation, and it you know talks about the you know the futurist events that's coming, and it talks about the Armageddon, and it talks about the grand war and battle. And very interestingly, Imam Bukhari puts you know, Kitab al-Fitan, you know, at the end of the book. So, you know, I just thought that this is interesting to know. And in that book, Al-Malhamat al-Kubra, and, you know, the Armageddon, like, the same words are used. So I was thinking that how much we have in you know, in similar, you know, in terms of predictions that have been made in you know, in the Bible and also the Sahih Bukhari.
That's a great observation. The similarities with the Bible and the Quran or authentic Sunnah from Sahih Sallam is numerous. Numbers are uncountable. Why do you think they're similar in the light of Islamic philosophy?
The
you know, Jesus, right? Jesus, you know, everyone knows that from some perspective we love him. They love him tremendously, emphasize the love for him. His narrative, miraculous birth, Mary, miraculous birth, Gabriel, these type of things, God intervention, support for her. If you look to the chapter of Mary in the Quran, the entire chapter called Maryam, as you know, and you look to the book of Luke, chapter 1, starting from verse 1 and on, look at the similarities between the two narratives. Gabriel is mentioned, birth is mentioned, the divine birth, of course, is mentioned, the struggles she went through, the visit of this angelic form is mentioned, the help of God is there, not to be sad is there, that this person is going to be a blessed person, a helper. It's very similar. Tremendously similar. The list goes on. If you look at the book of Matthew, Mark, and other places, statement, phrases that are exactly the same that are found in the Quran, for example. Some examples are exactly the same by meaning, and some are exactly by word. Some things that are very deep, fundamental, and some things that are secondary. Deep, fundamental, the concept of prayer. Jesus' prayer. His statements, you find that in the Quran. However, but statements like, I think you've heard of this, حَتَّى يَلِجَ الْأَمْرُ فِي السَّمِّ الْخِيَاطِ. What does that mean?
You know, the...
Yes. Until the camel goes through the eye of the needle. That's a Quranic verse. Exactly. But the phrase, going through the eye of the needle, that phrase has been exactly used by word in the Quran as well. And the examples go on. Many examples. But what I think is very important to people, for people to really understand, is that the concept of Islam and Christianity, for example, should not be a thing of animosity, an intrinsic thing of animosity. Why is that? If we look historically, for example, textually, so many similarities, no doubt about that. Okay? Historically as well, people don't know, but they've lived side by side for so long. Bishop Simeon. Bishop Simeon, he was the Syrian Arab Christian group, is usually known as the Eastern Christians, speaking Aramaic and these things, you know, Western Christians, Eastern Christians, these things. He was one of the earlier pioneers who had really intermingled with the Islamic Muslims that when in Syria they started to become Muslim, started to spread over there. What was the question they were discussing? They were discussing, Bishop Simeon and the head bishop at that time, the head Catholicus at that time, through letters, of why people were comfortable with the Islamic philosophy from their religion. Why is that? And then what's interesting in his statement, the Catholicus to Bishop Simeon, he says, because and or Islam is not an enemy to Christianity. He says that clearly. But instead, they are the supporters and respecters of our religious folk, our textual references, and also our places of worship. He mentions that specifically. Do you know Ibn Qadama, rahmatullah alayhi, Abdullah ibn Abbas, others, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, historically, they talked about how Prophet Muhammad, he never took down a church. He never took down a synagogue. He never took down a place of worship for Zoroastrians. That was for many years from the early pioneers that led this teaching, this empire. Christian scholars used to go visit the Prophet Muhammad in Medina. And when they wanted to pray, they pray inside the mosque in front of the Muslims.
Yes.
And the Prophet would say, let them pray.
Yes.
And they used to talk to him. They used to say, you know, they'd go to him and they'd discuss. Belief in God, we all agree that. belief in the concept of meeting God, everyone believes in that. They already agree on all these things. Concept of prophets, gods, Jesus, they agree with these. But at times they discussed with him, they wanted to know if this guy was actually a prophet of God or not. That's what they want to know. So for example, the Wahf from Najran, there was a group of people from the southeastern region of the Arabian Peninsula, they go to their scholars, and they talk to them. They already agreed, everyone agrees the concept of life after death, the concept of one God, the concept of meeting God, these other things. They were just trying to figure out if this guy was actually a prophet or not. Yeah. And what happened, eventually they considered that element, and they followed through with it. Now, many people have heard of William Durant, right? William Durant, Story of Civilization. He writes a statement, and in his statements, he says Islam is basically not an enemy to Christianity. It's quite simple. He said it straight up. And then he talks historically. He says there were times in which, unfortunately, Muslims conducted themselves in a certain fashion. But that wasn't the rule. That was the, what? The exception. That wasn't the rule. He goes on to say there were actually foremost in humanitarian aid, and the concept of human rights, and all that. So this is something very important to consider. It never was. And if you look historically in the textual exegesis of the Quran, you find a lot of works by Christian scholars inside of it. There's none of Riwayat Bani Israel. It's full of this information. It's full of information. A lot of their opinions, their point of views on things, on statements, among other things as well. So this is something very important for people to consider. And to remember that he had a great one. So Imam Bukhari, yes, toward the end of his work, was about six chapters before the end. He has that section, Kitab al-Fitan. And in the book of Revelation, in the New Testament, there is that section in which it is a revelation of dreams. Is it coincidence? God knows. But what happens is, how books were made, they usually started with a narrative at first, and it ended at the end. What they did was that there was a narrative, there was a story. So consequently, there was an introduction body, and then there was a conclusion. The ideology, the conclusion, time changes, people change, and there's a time in which you meet God. Imam Bukhari, he starts his work with the concept of the intrinsic element of the human being, the importance of intention. Yes. That's how he starts. Goes through this work all the way towards the end. And towards the end, he mentions that chapter. Mm-hmm. This too, the concept of remembering certain things, circumstances. Any other questions, or observations? But that point, again, I think it's very important for people to know that. Islam is not at animosity with Christianity. It supports religious folk of Christian or Jew, Zoroastrian. It is quite pluralistic. It's very pluralistic, actually. It should be, as it was taught philosophically. And it is welcoming. And it hopes for the success of people, individuals, worldwide, wherever they may be. Malik ibn Anas, for example, a great imam, he used to say, regardless of a person's theology, they can live in any type of Islamic environment.
Yes.
They can do it, they can live with anyone. That's Imam Malik, and it's passed away the year 1793. Okay, brothers and sisters, we'll stop here. We went over. Take care. Assalamu alaikum.